into marvelous light. I'm running out of darkness, out of shame. By the cross, you are the truth. You are the life. You are the way.
Welcome once again to the People of the Free Gift podcast, where we ground believers in their identity in Christ and equip them to reach out to those caught in religion. We're glad you joined us. We have been talking about, starting last week, we're going to take 17 weeks and talk about Jesus on the cross, the passion of Jesus Christ. And that word passion really says a lot. It says that this was the reason why Jesus came. As he came to fulfill his identity as the Messiah, he knew that he must die. He knew that he must pay the price for our sins. And last week we started talking about that, and we talked about three very heavy things. We talked about how Jesus died to please his heavenly Father. We talked about how he died to learn obedience and to be made perfect. And we talked about how he died to absorb the wrath of God. And if you weren't here last week, I would strongly suggest you get a DVD from last week, because that was heavy waters to start on. And we're picking up from there, week two. So here we go. Go ahead, and as we are starting out, go ahead and turn to Romans chapter 5, verse 6. And the first reason today that we're going to explore is that Christ suffered and died to show the wealth of God's love for sinners. We're going to talk a lot today about love and power, and how Jesus demonstrated the love of God and the power of God through the cross. And in Romans chapter 5, starting in verse 6, the Apostle Paul gives us a quick synopsis on what our state was like when Jesus died for us. So here we go. Romans chapter 5, verse 6. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. So Paul says, if you want to know what you were like or what the people were like when Jesus died for them on the cross, here's a quick synopsis in three shots. You were powerless, you were sinners, and you were God's enemies. And yet, Jesus died willingly for us. And to get a capture on this, he says, you know, very rarely will someone die for a really good man. And once in a while, you do hear that. People who are willing to lay down their life because they believe in someone or something. And they're willing to go. And, you know, I think of the people who serve in the military, that they really believe in things like freedom and honor. And they're willing to go to other places and risk their lives to fight for those things. I think of people who have been willing to follow individuals and been willing to die for them. But very rarely, and I don't think at all, do you find that somebody was willing to lay down their life for somebody that they just don't believe is a good person. I mean, that wouldn't make any sense. Usually when we're thinking that somebody who's not a good person is about to die, we almost rejoice inwardly. Even though we feel bad about it, we kind of do. We see somebody gets the death sentence and we're thinking, good. Even though we feel a little bit bad inside about it. But Jesus, he didn't respond that way. And I want you just to think about somebody in your life that's caused you harm. Somebody that has stood in your way at some point, made things hard for you. Maybe you honestly felt like they were your enemy. They were your rival. They were the person that, you know, Satan has put in your life just to make it miserable. I want you to think about that person. And I want you to picture yourself being willing to die for that person. To exchange your life so that they can keep theirs. We can't even picture that. We can't even imagine doing that. And yet that's what Jesus did for us. Because our state was that we were completely and absolutely rebellious. It says that we were God's enemies. We were, whether we wanted to admit it or not, we were, as the Bible says, we were captive by Satan. We were part of his camp. We were on his team doing his will and rebellious against God. And then we encountered Jesus Christ and we accepted the truth and we laid down our arms and we surrendered. And at that moment, it says that we were reconciled to God as we accepted the love that was poured out on us. One of the most famous verses in the Bible is John 3:16 that says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." That came in the context of a conversation that Jesus was having with one of the religious leaders of the Jewish people, Nicodemus. And Nicodemus came at night because he was scared of his fellow leaders and what they would think of him. But Nicodemus had some questions. And he was seeing some stuff that Jesus was doing that he couldn't explain apart from God being at work in some way, shape, or form in Jesus' life. And he just had to clarify for himself. And so he talks to Jesus. And it's a famous conversation, and Jesus tells him, "You must be born again." Nicodemus didn't understand that. And so Jesus says, "Well, let me help you from an event in that you're very familiar with in the Old Testament." In the book of Numbers, there's a story, and the book of Numbers really should have been the book of complaining, because that's all they ever did. The Israelites had just been freed from Egypt, and they were on their way to the promised land. God's providing for every single need that they have. And they're just complaining and complaining and complaining. Like, why can't we go be slaves in Egypt again? It was so nice back there. And God, every once in a while, God would just get fed up with it. And so one of those times, God sent serpents that would just start attacking the Israelites. And so people started getting sick and they started dying. And so they cried out to Moses and they're, "Moses, maybe he'll listen to you. Help us." And so Moses goes before God, and God tells him to erect a bronze serpent on a pole. Hold it up high, and everybody who looked at this pole with the serpent on it would be healed. And Jesus says, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And then he follows it up. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." You know what God was giving Moses there in the wilderness, in the desert? He was giving them a picture of Jesus dying on the cross. If you track down the symbols in the language, bronze and serpent together equals sin being judged. And everyone who looked at the symbol of sin being judged on this pole, they would be healed. And Jesus says, "For God so loved the world," which we usually read that and we say, God loved the world so much. He loved the world this much. But literally in the Greek, what it says is that for God loved the world in this way. This is the way in which God showed his love for us. Because, as we're going to learn a little bit later, love is always active. Love is a verb. It's not a feeling. It's not emotion. It's not something you say. It is an action. that you do, something that you do to communicate and to show that you love. And the greatest act of love was God sending his Son to die on a cross for our sins. Secondly, Christ suffered and died to show his own love for us. You see, it wasn't just the Father's love in which, you know, God said, okay, son, this is what you're going to have to do. And Jesus was kind of kicking and screaming and saying, no, 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 I don't want to. And, you know, the Father just says, well, no, you're going to do it because I'm the Father and you're the Son. That's not the way it works. This was a plan from the creation, from the foundation of the world in which God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit together said, this is how we are going to save humanity after they have rebelled, after they have fallen. And Jesus in John chapter 15, after he was talking about his relationship and the dynamic of the relationship that his disciples could have with him, he said to them this in verse 12, my command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. And Jesus went on to say that anybody who he tells the truth to, anybody who he shares God's truth with and who receives it, is a friend of his. And Jesus says that he laid down his life for his friends as the greatest symbol and the greatest act of love that has ever been demonstrated. And as John tells us in his epistle, we love because he first loved us. Our love is always, in a sense, reactive. And Jesus in Matthew 20, verse 26, he says, as he was talking about how the Gentiles lord it over those that are under them, and they tell him what to do, and he says, not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus knew what his mission was. Jesus came in order to pay the price for our sins. As he said it, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. And it shouldn't surprise us that our mission and our purpose is the exact same as his. He went to heaven and then he gave us the Holy Spirit and he says, now, as I have loved you, now you love others. And something that we learn about love from these verses is that love is always active. It is a verb. It's not an abstract noun. It's not an adjective. It's not something that you can just put into, you know, words or into a card and say, I love you. If you say, I love you, and there's been nothing to communicate that, nothing behind it, the other person says, well, that's nice. And maybe on some level it makes me feel good, but I don't really see how that's lived out. I don't really feel that you honestly and truly love me. Love is not only active, but it's proactive. And so often our love for each other, the love that we show, is reactive. It's kind of based on, you know, this person's been nice to me, so I'm going to reach out to them. Or maybe it's a reciprocal thing where you kind of go back and forth, and as soon as the other person cuts off, then we're done. But Jesus, as we learned, we were powerless sinners and God's enemies. And the reaction to that, the normal and obvious reaction to that, would have been for God to pour out his wrath on us. He would have said, okay, I'm done. I'm starting over. You're through. I'm going to start with a new batch and we'll go from there. But Jesus wasn't just reactive. He was proactive. And that means that he loved us in spite of the fact that we weren't loving him. He said, my mission, my goal is to save this fallen humanity. I want to have a relationship with them again. I want to be restored to them. And so I'm going to take the initiative. I'm going to be proactive. I'm going to reach out and do the only thing that I can do that can save them from their sins. And that is for God to himself become a man, to live a perfect and holy life, and to die on a cross, absorbing his own wrath for our sins. And third, love is unconditional. The love of God is absolutely unconditional. We've learned that our state was one in which we did not deserve God to pour out his love on us. And yet, he absolutely, unconditionally loves us. He loves us so much that he paid the entire price for your sins and for mine, a debt that we could not ever pay, so that we might be reconciled to him. So any love that we show that is representative of the love of God, that is the love of Christ flowing through us, must be active, it must be proactive, and it must be unconditional as well. Third, Christ suffered and died to achieve his own resurrection from the dead. In John chapter 2, we're told a story of how Jesus went into the temple. And he got outraged. He saw that the people were taking advantage of the poor people who were coming and just trying to honestly bring a sacrifice as they were commanded in the scriptures. They were taking advantage of them financially. They were taking advantage of them spiritually. And Jesus got outraged. And he started just going, and he took a whip and he started cracking the whip and he started overturning tables. And the religious leaders, the Pharisees, they were standing there watching this. And in John chapter 2, verse 18, it says, "Then the Jews demanded of him, 'What miraculous sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all of this?'" Essentially, they were asking, "We know this is God's house. What right do you have to come into God's house and to do these things? You better show us a miraculous sign that only God can do in order for us to not take your life right now." Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." The Jews replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you're going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. And after he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. And then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. You know, without doing it, Jesus essentially was saying, "Raise, destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up." And I want you to see what Jesus just said. He didn't say that God would raise him from the dead. He didn't say, "My Father will raise me from the dead." He said, "I will raise myself from the dead." And this wasn't the only time he made this claim. In John chapter 10, when he was talking about being the good shepherd, he says in verse 17, "The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again." Notice, I lay down my life. Who's in control on the cross? He is. "Only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father." Jesus declared over and over and over again that his mission was to die, to suffer, and to die on a cross, and to be raised 3 days after from the dead. Over and over again, he claimed the authority to lay down his life and to raise it back up again. and the Pharisees several times wanted to stone him over stuff like this. They understood what he was saying. They understood that he was claiming to have the power and the authority of God and God alone. And here's what the resurrection is all about. Galatians 2:20, which is one of those verses that I suggest you memorize, you put in your heart, and you just meditate on it over and over and over again. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me, and he gave himself up for me. Paul says this. He says, at the moment when you lay down your arms and you accept Jesus as your Savior and as your Lord, he says, you were crucified with Christ. You died right with him. Your old nature was gone. It was dead. Your old life, your old self, was crucified with Christ. And he tells us in Romans that as we died with Christ, and baptism is just a symbol of that, that you go under the water as a symbol of your death, and then when you come out, you are risen to new life in Jesus Christ. That just as he was risen from the dead, so we too are risen from the dead. An eternal life starts the moment that you lay down your life and surrender to Jesus Christ. And at that moment, an exchange happens. We talked about the first part of the exchange last week. That he absorbs God's wrath. He took every one of our sins upon ourselves. In fact, it says he became sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God. He gets our sin, we get his righteousness. And then the second part is that we say, Father, forgive us. And he says, I forgive you, and I now come and live inside your heart. He takes up residence within us. And just think about that. The God of the universe. And the Bible talks about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all taking up residence within us. The God of the universe lives inside of you now as a believer in Jesus Christ. No wonder Paul said, you are a new creation in Christ. All things have been made new. Now everything changes. Now where it says that before we were dead in trespasses and sins, now it says we are made alive in Christ. It says that we were a slave to our sin before. Now it says we have been set free. Amen. Completely set free. And so now he says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith. Whose faith? Faith of the Son of God, who loved me and he gave himself up for me. I want you to understand this, that nothing that you do as a Christian is you doing it. Absolutely nothing. Even faith. We say that everything comes by faith, and yet Paul tells us that faith is a gift. It comes with the Holy Spirit. Everything that God has to offer you, he offers you and gives you the moment that you accept him. Ephesians says that we have been blessed with every spiritual blessing in Christ. There is nothing that God will ever call you to do that he has not already equipped you to do. He lives on the inside of you. And every single moment, every single decision, every single thing he calls you to do, it's simply this. You have a choice. You can either shut him off and do things your own way by your own habits, your own patterns, your own sinful past that's still there. Or you can open up the floodgates and let him free. You can just let him flow out, and he will show his faith. He will show his peace.
He will show his joy, his life, his love to a lost and fallen world. And we'll stand back and say, that does not make any sense. I could not have possibly have done that. And Paul would say, and Jesus would say, of course you can't. But I can. And Paul would turn around and say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Because it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. That is the gift of the cross.
Jesus said, freely you have received, freely give. And so if you go to www.peopleofthefreegift.com, you can access all of our articles, all of our videos, all of our podcasts, and everything else our ministry has to offer completely for free. For those who are in a position who are led of the Lord, we do appreciate your donations, and you can do so through that same website. We'd love to connect with you, and so you can catch up with us through the website, through Facebook, through Twitter, Google+, and Pinterest. And we'd love to hear your ideas, your comments, your questions for future podcasts.
Into marvelous light, I'm out of darkness, out of shame. By the cross, you are the truth. You are the truth.